Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you for coming. My name is Alexander Kairu. I am a professor in the Center for the Study of Contemporary Muslim Societies, and I teach in the MA program on contemporary Islamic thought and Muslim societies. We've been running a series of public lectures at QFIS. So we've been running a series of lectures this year at QFIS in the center on topics that fall under the purview of the Center for Contemporary Muslim Societies within the vision of QFIS. And we've had a number of distinguished speakers before today, including Professor Sari Hanafi from the American University of Beirut, Professor Hamid Dabashi from Columbia, Professor John Bowen from Washington University at St. Louis, who've spoken on topics as varied as the role of Arabic language in the social sciences, Islamic liberation theology, and Islamic law in the United Kingdom. Today, it is my pleasure to welcome Dr. Frank Peter, who since 2010 has been professor of Islamic and Middle Eastern studies at the University of Bern in Switzerland. Frank was trained in history and in Islamic studies in Germany and in France, but he's also worked in the Netherlands, in Leiden, where we first met. His first book, based on his PhD research, was on late Ottoman mandate Syria, the nation building, imperialism, and industrialization in Damascus. Since then, he has moved on. He has edited and co-edited a number of books, edited volumes, and special issues of peer-reviewed journals, including the most recently a book entitled Islam and the Politics of Culture in Europe, Memory, Aesthetics, Art, from Bielefeld. And for the last decade, Islam in Europe has been the main research interest of Frank, who has focused in particular on debates about Islam and secularism in France, where he's been conducting fieldwork for many years. Frank told me that he's now working on two book projects. The first one is a study of how a wide range of social, political, and religious actors, including Muslims themselves, think about integration and rationalize the project of government of Muslims in France. So a study, in other words, of what Frank calls secular rationalities of government of Muslims in France. The second project is a textbook, a much needed textbook on Islam in Europe, which has become a field of study on its own, which will explore connections that debates about Islam in Europe routinely attach to Islam, connections that go far beyond gender, far beyond religion, including questions of gender, history, colonialism, delinquency, violence, humor, ethnicity, social class, etc. So the textbook will ask, what is it that makes possible the kinds of connections that are regularly attached to debates on Islam in Europe? And what might that tell us about secularism as a mode of political governance? Secularism, which one would expect, precisely treats religion separately as a separate sphere and tries to regulate it accordingly. Okay, so this is very briefly the context of Frank Peter's own research and research interests. Today he will speak to us about Islamophobia, from the margins to the center, European Islamophobia between fandoms, nationalism and liberal culture. Islamophobia, as you know, is a new term, a relatively new term, in both in European languages as well as in Arabic, that has become nevertheless widespread in media and political debates in Europe, but also in the Arab world. Now, there's been a lively debate in the West about what is the usefulness of this term, how can we define the concept of Islamophobia, What does it include and what does it exclude? Can it be measured with any degree of precision? Can it be compared over time and space and with other forms of racisms and fears? What may be its causes and how can it be fought? Frank's presentation will hopefully shed some light on these questions and highlight perhaps some of the problems inherent in the concept of Islamophobia itself. Frank will speak for 45, 50 minutes and then we'll open up the floor for discussions. Frank, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Hello. Thank you for the introduction. I would like to start out by thanking Qatar Faculty of Islamic Studies for inviting me and thanking you for coming to this talk. In the next 45 minutes, approximately, I will speak about a topic which is very closely related to the debate about Islamophobia, and it is indicated in the first line of my title, from the margins to the center, which I would paraphrase as the question, are we currently witnessing in Europe a development where Islamophobia, which is closely associated with more radical extremist political movements and intellectuals, is passing from the margins of society to the mainstream, political field in European countries? This is the question I'm interested in this talk. To put it very briefly, the main aim of my argument is to demonstrate that this question can be answered in two very different ways, depending on how we conceptualize mainstream politics in Europe and how we conceptualize Islamophobia. And there are at least two strikingly different ways to understand politics, mainstream politics in relation to Islamophobia. And these different understandings of Islamophobia have important implications for scholarly work and for practical work against Islamophobia. So in a bit more detail, the talk will be in three parts. In the first part, to summarize very briefly before I start, in the first part, I will deal with the terminological issue. As you perhaps know, there's the term, Alexander just mentioned it, Islamophobia re-entered our vocabulary 20 years ago, approximately, in Western Europe. Now there are a couple of authors who do not use this term, but other terms such as anti-Muslimism, hostility towards Islam, hostility towards Muslims. In this first part, I want to clarify why the term Islamophobia is being replaced by other terms. What are the differences between these different terms? And I want to answer the question whether we, what are the points of convergence between the different terms, Islamophobia and hostility towards Islam, etc. And I want to suggest that there is a strong common kernel to all these terms, and this is, you find at the bottom, the definition, which I think encompasses most of the terms which are being used today when we speak about Islamophobia. And I would say that Islamophobia designates negative and often emotional attitudes, attitudes which are held primarily by individuals towards Islam, and these attitudes result from stereotypes and prejudice. This is the most common understanding of Islamophobia or anti-Islamism, hostility towards Islam, etc. This is the shared understanding which enables the current debate. I want then move on in the second part to ask whether, if we define Islamophobia as I just did, whether this definition of Islamophobia can be criticized for being political. I'm asking this question because if you use the term Islamophobia in scholarly debates in Europe or elsewhere, very often you will be criticized and it will be claimed that this term has a political bias. So I want to examine in the second part what kind of politics are being conducted if you speak about Islamophobia in this way, if you equate it with emotional, pre-reflective attitudes informed by prejudice against Islam. And I want to argue that briefly that Islamophobia is today mostly conceived of as an illiberal, anti-liberal form of politics. And the individuals, the groups, the scholars who mobilize against Islamophobia from a liberal point of view. That's a very important part of my argument. And I want to argue that it is very difficult or impossible to criticize the concept of Islamophobia for its political bias, because the political bias is liberal. It is mobilizing against Islamophobia should be normal in a liberal democracy. But I then move on to argue that the problem with this term Islamophobia is not a political one, because it's perfectly liberal, but its analytical scope is limited. It is unable to explain how complex structures of inequality are being reproduced. So I want to make a suggestion in the last part of the talk, what other concepts we could analyze how the conditions which Muslims have for making use of their religious freedom in Europe, how these conditions, the unequal conditions, can be analyzed. So let me start. I said that the term Islamophobia has been reintroduced into the vocabulary in Europe in the 1990s. A major factor in this development was the publication of a report in the UK 1997 with the title Islamophobia, a Challenge for Us All. The authors of this report adopted the term Islamophobia from British Muslim groups active at the time. In the last decade, many people have grappled with this term, and a variety of other terms have been suggested. What is in stake when people refuse Islamophobia and speak rather about, for example, hostility towards Muslim? There are real differences at stake. I do not want to deny this. I give you only one example. In Germany, the German Islam Conference, together with important academics, Heiner Bielefeld, notably, who is United Nations Rapporteur for Religious Freedom and Belief, it coined the term hostility towards Muslims. And they defend this term because this term allows legal action without being obliged to define Islam. And they would say the state or public authorities, legal courts, cannot define what is Islam and what is not. But we can define and we can identify acts of collective hostility towards Muslims. And this is illegal in under certain conditions. And so we stick to this term, hostility towards Muslims. So it is clear that there, in some cases, these terms relate to concrete differences, notably with regard to what you can do in the legal field. But nevertheless, you can define a very simple shared definition of Islamophobia, which applies to all of these different terms. And this definition is characterized by three features. Very simply, first of all, Islamophobia designates an attitude or a perception which is negative. All sides agree on that. Both the people who are Islamophobic and the addressees of Islamophobic speech would consider this attitude negative. And it is an attitude or perception which is ascribed from outside to Islam and or Muslims. Secondly, stereotypes. The second feature is Islamophobia designates an attitude or perception of Islam which is stereotypical, by which I mean simply that complex differences inside Muslim communities and differences between Muslims and other persons are reduced into binary differences. The temporality, the changes characteristic for Muslim religious practice through history are being denied. Islamophobia works through essentializing. So many authors have pointed to the continuity of certain mechanisms of Orientalist representation as being very important for current contemporary Islamophobic discourse. The third overlapping criteria, Islamophobia designates attitudes or perceptions of Islam which are to a large degree emotional and or effective. The point of Monique is they are pre-reflective. And so mobilization against Islamophobia regularly, routinely emphasizes that more education, circulation of proper knowledge is necessary to correct the perception, the wrong perception of Islamophobia, Islam, and in this way to eliminate or to diminish Islamophobia. So these three characteristics, emotionality and affective stereotypes, are important, are the shared features of the debate about Islamophobia. I want to emphasize that there's a simple reason why, in spite of semantic differences, these three features are shared, I would say, by all definitions of Islamophobia. I mentioned the term was introduced by activists, broadly speaking, and the debate is kept going by either public authorities, Muslim groups, interreligious groups, who have an interest, who are motivated by the aim to name certain phenomena which affect negatively and in an illegitimate way specific populations. This is what these people share, and because of this reason, the criteria pre-reflective attitude, emotionality, and stereotypes are always singled out, are constitutive of the term Islamophobia, because this pre-reflective stereotypical attitude is bad in itself, it is illegitimate, it is, we would all agree, contrary to proper scientific approaches, and it tends to hurt members of this group or all members of this group in multiple ways. So I just would like to mention once, I'll come back to it later, that Islamophobia is, of course, defined in analogy to racism. Right? This is in many ways, a shared grammar with the way racism is being currently used, the term racism and Islamophobia. So this is a very simple definition, but even if you look at sophisticated attempts to define Islamophobia, you would find that this is in concordance with what these authors arrive at. I mentioned one example, Eric Blake, a political scientist from the US, I believe, has undertaken a sophisticated discussion of different definitions of Islamophobia with the aim to work out a definition which allows comparative measurements of Islamophobia in comparison to racism or antisemitism. And what the solution he arrives at is he defines Islamophobia as indiscriminate negative attitudes or emotions directed at Islam or Muslims. These are the ontologically significant aspects of Islamophobia, because they are the ones that we assume influence societal interactions that we care about. And this is precisely the logic which guides the most basic aspects of definitions of Islamophobia. So the question I want now to raise in the second part is, like, if we agree that, if we accept my attempt to elaborate a common definition of the term Islamophobia, would this definition of Islamophobia, could it be criticized for its political bias? And I said, I mentioned this question because the term Islamophobia is regularly being criticized. And even if, I should add this, even if the balance has shifted, I think the article I mentioned here by Brian Klug, Islamophobia, a term, a concept comes of age, shows very well that I think the majority of social scientists working in the field would now accept the term. And it is not, I think it's unrealistic to think that it will vanish, right? But nevertheless, there is criticism which is being addressed at this concept, and this criticism claims that the term is political. I give you one example by an anthropologist, John Bowen, who was just mentioned, who I think in 2005 or 2006 has precisely expressed doubts or with regard to the usefulness of this term. And he points out, if you look at France, if you look at the law which was adopted to prohibit Islamic headscarves in public schools, you would find that those who defend this law are being attacked for Islamophobia. And Bowen writes, you might think what you want about that law, but most French people and many Muslims support it. They have diverse reasons for supporting this law, all the way from seeking to protect schoolgirls, etc. But because the term, and this is the point I'm interested in, because the term Islamophobia has come to be used in this overly broad way and is highly polemical, using it as an analytical term is a bit dicey. And this is like the argument he gives in order to say that the term is problematic. And I think the point I want to make is that this, perhaps this was, is partly true for 2005. I do not want to deny that the term Islamophobia is used to criticize people who adopt restrictions on religious practices. But it clearly misidentifies the logic which drives the mobilization against Islamophobia and the logic in which this term is being justified in public debates. And it is justified on basis of human rights, it is justified in relation to scientific knowledge, proper expertise on Islam, and it is just, it functions in the framework of the liberal state. Islamophobia is being identified again and again with unscientific stereotypes, with irrational attitudes by individuals, and the mobilization against it relies precisely on expert knowledge, on differentiating between different types of Islam, and recourse to the legal courts. So if we look at the mobilization against headscarves or other legal restrictions on Muslim religious practice, we find that the term Islamophobia is in fact rarely used. And this is in France the case and also in other countries. And it's not a coincidence, but it reflects the fact that the major associations working today against Islamophobia base their argumentation on human rights and the right to religious freedom. I give you only one example, the Collective Against Islamophobia in France, which was created in 2003-04, and which is like a very professional, successful organization working, mobilizing against Islamophobia. They precisely have an understanding of an Islamophobia which frames Islamophobia as an offense. It's an, it is illegal, and all they seek to do is to raise awareness for the legal possibilities to fight for your rights, to defend your rights at the working place and universities elsewhere. And they have hired two or three full-time lawyers who do this, and they produce booklets, etc., to raise awareness for the possibilities which the legal system offers, right? And so they, I found like one or two instances where this collective identifies the law against headscarves as Islamophobic. They surely do, but it is something which is absolutely marginal to their argumentation, and this argumentation is precisely based on the idea, as you find here below, that we need to induce the state, the French Republic, to fulfill its obligation to protect French Muslim citizens, to guarantee their security, and to promote living together. So Islamophobia is seen as something which exists outside of the framework of the French Republic, outside of the framework of liberalism. It is an aberration, it is something which was produced through the crisis of French radicalism, republicanism since the 1980s, which they, and this they emphasize again and again. So this example of the headscarf affair is, of course, only one example, but it's a very significant example in the French context. And I would argue that if we evaluate the analytical and practical potential of this term Islamophobia and look at this case of the headscarf affair, the fact that this term Islamophobia is of no use to speak about this law is very significant. Islamophobia is, like racism, a term which, when it is applied to specific discourse or practice, it has a very strong charge of denunciation. It is a conduct or an attitude which is unacceptable in a liberal state. But at the same time, as this example and others would show, it is a term which is applicable only to a small number of practices. By small number of practices, I mean practices like vandalizing mosques, aggressing people, etc. There's an increasing number of that, but it's, of course, overall speaking, it is a small number of practices in French and European nation states. So the fact that this term Islamophobia has such a strong denunciatory character is linked to the fact that it is applicable only to a small number of phenomena. So the question which I raised in the beginning, is Islamophobia moving from the margins to the mainstream, is a question you would basically answer with no, unless a full-blown transformation of the political system in Europe would come about, versus really illiberal forms of politics, you could not say that Islamophobia, if you define it in this way, moves into the mainstream. It remains associated primarily with radical, populist, extreme right-wing movements. So the point I want to make is that if we identify Islamophobia in this way with pre-reflective attitudes, emotional prejudice against Islam, many things are being left out. Of course, the term Islamophobia is necessary because acts by individuals which are inspired by hatred or prejudice against Islam and Muslims do exist, but many other things are being left out. And one of these things is obviously our laws. They are perfectly legal means for discriminating against Muslims. With this concept of Islamophobia, there's hardly anything you can do with this. You have no analytical grasp of it. Secondly, there is a number of factors which affect in a negative way the conditions under which the right to religious freedom can be made use of. And these conditions, so these indirect ways of affecting, of restricting the right to religious freedoms, are also something which is hard to be, which you cannot analyze if you conceptualize Islamophobia in this way. So I would say that the reason for this, if we pause for a brief moment, is the reason for this is that Islamophobia, the concept, is being tailored for use primarily in legal battles, public debates, where specific crimes against Muslims, specific acts of discrimination are being highlighted and often resolved in legal courts. And the notion of discrimination, which is underlying, can be characterized by three elements. There's the notion that the what of Islamophobia is like it's hostility, it's discrimination, rejection of Muslims. This is what is happening, what is being mobilized against. There's a clear reason which is given, prejudice. And whereas the how, by what means, this Islamophobia is manifesting itself is answered in a very simple way. What is targeted here is individual acts of discrimination. So any act which negatively affects the right to religious freedom of Muslims, which has a more complex how dimension, like by which I mean like how is this act of discrimination manifesting itself, anything which has a more complex how dimension, like the law against headscarf, which was promulgated, adopted after a year-long debate and many experts legitimating it, anything with a more how complex dimension is being left out. It is almost impossible to do analytically anything about such an act of discrimination. So what I want to say is that it is the emphasis which is placed in many studies about Islamophobia on the use of stereotypes and monolithic representations is attractive in a certain sense because it allows you or me as a researcher not to take position politically. It is to identify a certain discourse or a certain scholarly work as using stereotypes makes clear that this discourse is wrong. We would all agree on that, not only in the academy, but more generally in public sphere. So it is something which is attractive because it allows you not to take position politically, but at the same time it is analytically weak. So what I want to suggest in this third part is to start out from a different angle. And this angle is something which many scholars have drawn attention to as another central feature of the politics of Islam in Europe and the debate about Islam in Europe, namely what you could call a certain conceptual confusion surrounding Islam, if you understand Islam as a religion. And this confusion of around Islam, the fact that Islam is being associated with issues of with social conflicts, with ethnicity, with culture, etc., with gender issues, this confusion is a very important factor, many scholars would claim, which enables various forms of direct or indirect discrimination. I put here a quote by a very important scholar who has written on Islam in Europe and many other issues, whom you know, Olivier Roy, who described this phenomenon, which I am interested in here, this conceptual confusion, in the following way, or it's like it's a demand, a criticism, which he formulates in this way. If it is immigration or the Middle East that is the source of difficulty, then that has to be said clearly. And we can stop the endless stream of quotations from the Quran. If it is only Islam that is at issue, then we have to stop thinking about Islam from the perspective of the banlieue, the problematic neighborhoods in France, and the banlieue from the perspective of Islam. So this is what he writes in the introduction to Laïcité, French Secularism Confronts Islam. And he has made similar statements in many other books, and many other scholars would agree with what he says, in the sense that this mixing, this confusion between Islam as religious tradition and many other issues, matters which are external to it, is a source of creating, enabling discriminatory practices. So the question is, of course, which you have to raise, like, how is this possible? How is this possible in a routine manner? How is it possible for policymakers? How is it possible for intellectuals to mix Islam with matters which we would consider external to it, external to religion? So the argument, what I wanted to suggest here is based on governmentality studies, broadly speaking, and on the concept of political rationality. So the basic idea is simply that Islam is, of course, not only perceived as a religious tradition from the point of view of the state or civil society, but it is constructed in different and multiple ways in relation to culture, ethnicity, for example. So you could formulate it to say that different political rationalities are being applied routinely to Islam. And political rationality designates here simply a discursive field inside which the exercise of power is being conceptualized. So rationality is necessary, is what structures policy making and political debates, because it enables the reflexive practice of power. It enables to reason and to justify a specific exercise of power and its aims. This does not say that policy making is always being fully rationalized, of course not, but it regularly is so, and it regularly needs to be rationalized. And these rationalities function in relation to a specific notion of truth, not necessarily scientific, but they are related to a notion of truth. So rationality, you could say, is characterized by three features. First of all, it implies a notion of the reality which is to be governed. So, and this is important and interesting for us, because the empirical observation tells us that Islam is being mixed up with other issues which we would regularly consider external to it, different from religion. And political rationality is something, is a tool which allows us to analyze how Islam is not only rationalized as a religion, but how different understandings of reality are being produced and are enabling the exercise of power. So one dimension of a political rationality is the on the level of epistemology. It is a specific notion of reality, the reality which is to be governed. The second one is political rationality enables to think and to plan specific aims, the aims of government, the task of government. And the third level is the subject form, which is to say that rationality implies a specific notion of the subject, for example, as autonomous or free, as socially determined in certain ways, etc., as a subject which is free to imagine, etc. So I want to give you one example to make this less abstract, the most obvious, the example, the rationality which is the most common to us, and certainly the most common to us when we talk about Islam, when we talk about secularism in Europe. This is the juridical one. On the level of epistemology, what we have is here legal norms which are applied to human acts. And they are applied in order to interpret human acts and to decide their legal status, the fact whether they are allowed or not. And ultimately, they are applied in order to adjudicate justice in most systems, to simplify somewhat. The subject form in this rationality is the individual is a bearer of rights and duties. Individuals are conceived as free and as responsible for their acts. Now this, I would argue, this juridical rationality, which is simply a way to order how people reason, debate about politics, is indispensable for any discussion on secularism, on Islam in Europe. By which I want to say that when we talk about secularism, when we talk about religious freedom of Muslims or other religious groups in Europe, what we do routinely is to dissect, to disassemble religion, a specific religious tradition, into particular acts, and examine the conformity of these acts, the possibility to practice these acts in secularism, which is in the first place understood as a legal order. So if we understand secularism as a legal order and look at the totality of legal norms, we can define what is the space of religious freedom. So this is, simply put, what I would say is like the juridical rationality, an indispensable basis for any debate about Islam in Europe. I want to contrast it with the second rationality, what I call the social rationality. To contrast with the juridical rationality, what do I mean by social rationality? On the level of what is out there, what the government takes into account, what it seeks to shape, to govern in a certain way, you could say the rationality of the social is aimed at and takes note of the existence of what we call the social, or what you can call social forces, social processes, something which became thinkable for humans in the course of the 19th century. And I'm basing myself here on a book primarily by Jacques Doncelot, The Invention of the Social, which examines this in the context of France. So in the context of the 19th century, people became aware that humans, individuals living together, through their interaction, produce certain social forces which exceed the totality of human acts and their intentions. Their processes, forces being generated through human interaction, which go beyond what human individuals intend or what they have done. So this you can name in various ways, of obviously, and there's like very, very much very sophisticated ways to examine this in sociology or social sciences. My point here is simply to identify a very basic, taken for granted way of looking at religion, which is not at all limited to academics or to universities, but which is part of public debates, and which is of course also part, it informs Muslim discourses in Europe, obviously too. And this is based on the recognition that there is something, a level of reality which we could call the social. To give you one example, the obvious example in France would be solidarity, the fact that Durkheim coined this term solidarity and created a popular theory in order to show that specific forms of social structure create different forms of how humans feel solidarity towards other members of the group. So with regard to religion or morality, quite independent but not necessarily unconnected to social scientific studies, this rationality of the social has offered a different way of thinking about why religious systems or traditions emerge and how they develop. The classic statement would then be Durkheim in a famous article from 1906 about the determination of moral facts, where he points out, yes, morality or religions, of course, may have transcendent aims. This is not of our concern. But what we can say with certainty is that moral facts are phenomena like any others. They consist of rules for action that are recognizable by certain distinctive characteristics. It should thus be possible to observe, to describe, and classify them, as well as to seek out the laws that explain them. So what Durkheim made possible and easily repeatable for many people in Europe is to think about religion, to understand specific religious traditions and practices as something which we can put into laws, that we can establish models or laws in order to explain the genesis and the function of religion quite independently of what the adherents of a religious tradition would say themselves. And the most common way in which this is being done, particularly with regard to Islam in Europe, is to consider specific Islamic practices as functional elements in broader social processes. For example, in Europe, it has become a commonplace to analyze the turn, the so-called revival of Islam or born-again Muslims, as something, as a process which needs to be explained in the light of processes of identity construction. So the point here is that religion is the absolutely contingent element which takes the place in what we call identity construction processes. And currently it is for specific populations religion, identity, but it might be something else in 10, 20 years. The way it functions, we can understand this process of turning towards Islam without taking into consideration what the people say, without taking into consideration the particularity of the of Islam as a religious tradition. So one example, which sounds crude, but it's by a renowned intellectual, the late French Cardinal Lustiger, who in 1989, when the first headscarf controversy broke out, tried to make an argument for seeking reconciliation and said, maybe the headscarf is just the equivalent to the dreadlocks of Rastafarians, since both could be considered as a sign of youth revolt, as an indicator of revolting youth. So in this sense, for him, less for many others, it is a functional equivalent. Right? It might be religion, totally different religions, etc., but in forms of social processes, both conducts can be considered as an indicator of youth revolt. That would be an example for how you can turn equal, identical, comparable, two very different practices from two very different religious traditions. So the point I want to make, the first is that the particularity of the category religion and the particular features of one religion like Islam can be eliminated in this rationality. A religion can be understood without reference to religious discourse. You can just understand it in the framework of general, universal, social processes, like the process of constructing self-identity. This can produce important effects, reassuring effects, on secular intellectuals. It has reassuring effects in the sense that it is a way to diminish or eliminate the difference between biographies, social conduct of religious individuals versus other individuals. So the social rationality is something which allows you to repackage Islam in universal categories. And it might well have positive effects on guaranteeing religious freedom, because this kind of line of argumentation allows you to say that in spite of apparent differences, the lifestyle of Muslims is not so different, because you can trace it back, you can analyze it, understand it in universal categories which are applicable to Muslims as much as to any other social or religious group. And this is an argument which has been quite popular and important in European debates in various countries. So this reassuring effect of this social rationalization of Muslim religiosities also depends on the notion of normality. I'm not saying that all these authors or people who use this rationality use this term normality, but normality indicates here the grammar in which they are thinking. Normality defines, this social rationality defines standards of what is a normal social practice in relation to a particular set of social conditions. And this is something which allows to defend as normal, as acceptable for society, specific practices which are new, culturally new and strange in a specific context, such as certain Islamic practices. So the analysis of problematic forms of Islamic practices, problematic because they are oriented towards a community and normative, can be and are regularly explained with reference to the problematic social context. And this is a way of making sense of these practices and normalizing them in a certain context. So two points to conclude this section. So such a designation of a certain practice as normal in a social context takes place in an order which is different from that of the law. There's a different kind of expertise which is brought into and a different understanding of reality which is referred to when we rationalize religion in a social perspective. But of course, such an analysis can feed back and can in turn impact on how the law is being interpreted. And this can happen in very different ways. It is a rationality which can be used to defend religious freedom, to maintain the scope of religious freedom, and the inverse is also true. The law against the headscarf in French school, of course, was also defended, legitimated through various forms of social analysis of the context in which this dress code is being implemented. So there is no, it is impossible to make a statement with regard to the effects of this social rationality. It can work for or against religious freedom. It's the first point, which is important. The second point is that the boundary between what various kinds of experts name a normal phenomenon, a normal form of religious practice, and what lies beyond this normal form of religious practice, the boundary is ultimately defined through an arbitrary act by one expert or a group of experts. Arbitrary, I mean, in this sense, of course, it can be well argued, it can be badly argued, but it is always defensible. It's always criticizable. Can always be attacked. And this shows very well in European debates, where the question what kind of practices are similar, are comparable, are normal, this question is being debated endlessly, and there's an increasing number of government-funded research projects which keeps looking into this question. So if the idea to bring in more scientific expertise, if this idea was aimed at streamlining public debate and finding a consensus, one would have to recognize now that this is not possible in the field of social analysis of Muslim practices. Yeah, let me conclude. So the most general point I want to make is that Islamophobia is certainly a necessary concept, but it is an insufficient term. It is insufficient if we are interested in analyzing and understanding how not only individual acts of hatred are committed against Muslims or Muslim institutions, but how the conditions under which Muslims make use of religious freedom are being shaped and often shaped in ways which are negatively affecting the scope of religious freedom. And I try to show that one way to look at this, to try to understand the broader context which is negatively affecting religious freedom, is to take note of the fact, to take seriously of the fact that Islam is not only a religion, it is not only constructed as religion in political decision making. And this is not a coincidence, it is not something which will one day stop. It is impossible to imagine a modern state which does not rely on social expertise, on religion. This might be the case in 100 years in the future, we know nothing about yet, but in the current state of affairs, any state in Europe, of course, relies on social expertise, and important amounts of money are spent on understanding within this social rationality the practice of Muslims. Through these rationalities, such as the social rationalities, various types of connections are being established between Islam as a religion and other non-religious matters. So this boundary, which we think so important between religion and the secular, is routinely being transgressed. And transgressed, I put it in quotation marks because, of course, this is a discursive transgression, if you want. It happens in the realm of knowledge production, but it is, of course, something which enables various forms of intervention by the state. So the point is, if we are interested in understanding how unequal conditions for religious freedom are reproduced, we need to adopt, first of all, a critical perspective approach to secularism. The second point is, we need to think about Islamophobia beyond prejudice and emotionality. These rationalities, such as the social one, enable to differentiate between religions and citizens in numerous ways, and this is perfectly legal, and it happens often through expert discourses or in relation to scientific expertise. And these discourses make function the law in specific ways, and they help to determine the interpretation of law, which means to say that the two have to be examined together. And we need to realize that the close association of Islamophobia with prejudice leaves out important factors which affect the way in which Muslims can practice their religion. So this sounds very complicated. There would be various other political rationalities which would need to be brought in. So the question is, how can we study the politics of Islam in Europe with such a complex tool, a set of analytical tools? That's an important question, a good question, but I think there's so much empirical evidence which shows that the politics concerning Islam in Europe are indeed complex, and that it would be not analytically helpful and legitimate to create national models which are based on the idea of a unified political field, on the idea of one way to rationalizing politics. So what would be necessary is to concentrate on local configuration of politics, on different combinations in which rationalities function, and different constructions of Islam, not only as a religion, but in relation to other categories. So either we acknowledge this complexity of politics, and I would argue that, of course, many Muslim groups acknowledge this in their practice, many people acknowledge this through what they do, but for scientifics it is more difficult because it implies abandoning a national perspective on politics in many ways. Either we acknowledge this complexity or we end up severely limiting our field of analysis, such as we do when we talk about Islamophobia, or we are obliged to notice again and again how the category of religion is being confused with other categories without being able to explain this confusion in a satisfying manner. So if I were to answer the question, are we moving from the margins, is Islamophobia moving from the margins to the mainstream currently, in Europe. What I wanted to show is that there are very different ways of conceiving of what is mainstream politics. And if we take seriously, if we try to work with this concept of political rationality, we are able to understand, to locate the production of inequality with respect to Muslims in mainstream politics, right? And that would make allow for a more critical perspective on liberal states. So this kind of concept allows for a different and a more critical perspective on where to locate the mainstream and margins. And at the same time, I think it shows that this idea that Islamophobia, as it is defined most commonly today, cannot move into the center of the political field. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this very stimulating presentation. I think you've demonstrated something that we try to tell our students all the time, which is the benefit of some theoretical insights to start to try and make sense of realities that are intrinsically very complex. So it was a wonderful example of how insights from Foucault and writers within that tradition can help shed new light on a phenomenon that we often experience but are unable to properly diagnose, properly understand, and make sense of. The floor is open for questions. I will be passing on the microphone because we will have a translation if anyone would like to start. Dr. Mohammed Khalifa, tafadhal.
Thank you very much for your very interesting talk. I would like to ask actually about the psychological dimension of Islamophobia, because Islamophobia يعني expresses actually the fear of Islam. So there is a psychological يعني aspect here. Of course, you mentioned something يعني about emotions and so on, but I think it's يعني bigger than that. يعني if you allow me, can we describe the West of being, you know, sick of Islam? And there is some sickness, or if we interpret now the word, the fear of Islam as actually a kind of sickness. Number two, how can you compare, or can we compare the rise of Islamophobia with the rise of anti-Semitism in the West? Is there any يعني, relation, you know, between the two expressions here? Number three, why only Islamophobia? And we did not hear actually in the West anything which has to do with, for example, Christianophobia, Judeophobia, Buddhism phobia, Hinduism phobia. Why Islamophobia? يعني is it something يعني special to Islam or and again يعني we need your advice, you know, for the Muslims how to combat Islamophobia in the West. Shukran, thank you.
I've taken your microphone, but is there another microphone? Because otherwise we'll be going back and forward all the time. Okay. Thank you for the questions. The first question, if I understood correctly, referred to the relative importance of the psychological dimension of Islamophobia, right? Yes. So I do not want to deny that there is an important psychological dimension to Islamophobia. But the point I was trying to make is there is a danger, if we talk so much about psychology, to individualize Islamophobia. And then Islamophobia becomes
very closely associated with isolated individuals who have extreme views and who are, generally speaking, marginal in society. And the most extreme, the most obvious, important example would be Anders Breivik in Norway, the terrorist who killed so many people like a couple of years ago, and who is psychologically instable. And this is, of course, like an important case, but it is a way to depoliticize Islamophobia, to consider Islamophobia as something which has to do with marginal, extreme individuals. So I think in this has to be kept in mind, and this I would never want to deny the psychological dimension of Islamophobia, but you need to ask how this psychological dimension relates to other discourses, and it is then primarily important to look at scientific discourses. So to look at legitimate forms of knowledge which allow you to discriminate against Muslims, this is what is interesting and important as a supplement. I'm not denying the importance of psychology, but one has to ask, is Islamophobia, is the discrimination of Muslims only something which is done by marginal individuals whose views are not respectable in society, like the views of certain right-wing political parties whose views would not be acceptable to a bourgeois liberal public? Or are there perfectly respectable forms of justifying why it is right and good and important to discriminate against Muslims, to restrict certain religious practices? So that's the balance I would want to keep. Now, can Islamophobia be compared to anti-Semitism? That's a very difficult question. Of course, anything can be compared, and it's useful to compare different phenomena. I think there are two different differences which are important. The first one, simply that Islamophobia emerges after the Holocaust, and this has created a different awareness of the potential effects of racism, generally speaking. And many people would, of course, deny the possibility to compare the two, but there are also many scholars in all European countries who would precisely with reference to the Holocaust argue we need to be more careful, we need to be thinking to take into consideration that many of the stereotypes of Muslims are so similar to the way Jews were stereotyped 100 years ago in Central Europe. And that is, there's a lot of scholarship which shows that the two can be compared and that there are many similarities on the level of stereotypes. The second difference would be then that Islamophobia, and that answers perhaps also your third question, Islamophobia is important for, many people have noted that, for the construction of Europe. The process of European unification is something which interrelates in many ways with drawing a boundary vis-à-vis Islam. The difference towards Islam is something which unites European nations which have many problems in their relation among each other. But the difference to Islam is something which in discourse on cultural production is something which unites Europeans, I think. And this is like, this is one reason why Islamophobia, why not Judeophobia, Christianophobia, etc. Well, I mean, it is first of all a name, right? It is a name which was given by Muslim activists in the 1990s, primarily in Britain, but also in other countries. And of course, it relates to the fact, or one condition for the name is that there was Muslim migration to Europe, and a sizable Muslim migration. And you would not have, there are like local Christian minorities, but there was no migration processes of this size in the 50s, 60s took place towards Europe. And I think this is certainly one important necessary factor for explaining why there's Islamophobia and not Christianophobia.
Okay, there's a في سؤال هنا بالعربي.
دكتور محمد اقبال جامعه قطر كليه الشريعه عندي سؤال حقيقه للدكتور اولا اشكره على المحاضره ويعني ارغب بسؤال في قضيه يعني مصطلح الاسلاموفوبيا هل هو مصطلح يعني انا اقول فيه شيء من التبسيط وتسطيح الواقع اذا اعتمدنا اذا اعتقدنا ان المصطلح مصطلح اعلامي يعني ظهر بالبي سي هو حقيقه ظاهره ظاهره الاسلاموفوبيا موجوده في الغرب موجوده في السياسه موجوده عند يعني في وسائل الاعلام بشكل واضح وسائل الغربيه والدليل مثلا انه رفض قبول تركيا يعني عدم قبول تركيا للاتحاد الاوروبي اظن ايضا له علاقه بقضيه الاسلاموفوبيا شكرا.
So the question is about the relationship between Islamophobia and the Turkish question and the way in which in particular the refusal of accepting Turkey within the EU might have played a role in European discourses on Islamophobia.
I think the refusal of it's not a refusal yet of the membership of Turkey into the European Union is a good example for the limits of the concept of Islamophobia, by which I mean that the country which is the most opposed to Turkey's membership in the European Union is Germany. And in Germany, no politician who is still active has openly argued that Turkey, because of its Muslim culture, cannot be a member of the European Union. Only politicians who are retired make this discourse, because it would not be acceptable in German political life to argue with reference to religion or culture or cultural history and to exclude Turkey from Europe. It would not be possible. Europe is liberal to the degree that such an argumentation would be tricky for mainstream politicians. So the former Chancellor Helmut Kohl has made this argument that Turkey is not Christian and hence cannot be European, but he's retired, of course. Helmut Schmidt has made a similar, also a former Chancellor. A very famous historian also has made this argument, but he's retired, he's still an important figure. So it is people who are not individuals, important individuals, personalities, who are not in active professional life, who make this argument. But in active politicians would be much more reluctant and would not refer to the factors of culture, civilization, religion, in order to justify it, in order to justify this exclusion. But of course, this exclusion of Turkey is wanted by the majority of the population in Germany and many other countries because of Muslim civilization in Turkey.
So there are two questions.
أشكر البروفيسور على هذه المحاضرة. طبعا كما نعرف هناك كثير من الصور النمطية والأحكام المسبقة عن الإسلام في العقل الجمعي الغربي من خلال ذلك النتاج الكبير الذي تركه رجال الكلوروس والاستشراق والأدباء عبر ما يزيد على 1400 عاما. ولكن السؤال لماذا لا تقبل أوروبا أن تكون هناك عدد من الكراسي في جامعاتها التي تعمل على تصحيح الصور النمطية عن الإسلام فكما نعرف أن هناك كثير من الكراسي تناول دراسة القرآن الكريم ودراسة الإسلام لماذا لا تكون هناك كراسي خاصة بتصحيح الصور النمطية عن الإسلام أليس هذا من الحرية بجانب كثير من الديانات التي لها كثير من الكراسي في الجامعات الأوروبية شكرا
سوزي The question is why there is not like a specific chair for correcting the image, negative image of the Islam. I think there is no specific chair for doing this kind of scholarship, but there are certainly many university academics in Europe who pursue. Pardon? Okay. So the thank you for the question. To my knowledge, there is. No chair which has been created to correct the image of Islam in Europe, but there is broad agreement, I would say, among the majority of scholars in the field that this, in the field of Islamic studies, of religious studies, of anthropology, In this field, there's an agreement among the majority of scholars that the image, the representation of Islam needs to be corrected. And this is something which emerged, I would say, in the 1990s, approximately. And so there are still influential scholars who would be in disagreement and who would make important points, hostile, let's say, antagonistic representations of Islam. You would still find this, certainly, but there's also an agreement, a recognition of, let's say, Orientalism. So the fact that there was the book by Edward Said has changed the way scholars in the West produce research. This is certainly true. And this does not affect all scholars, but it is certainly something which has a very important influence.
Well, thank you for your presentation. I have a number of, if you wish, comments and questions that have to do with the discussion in your presentation. One of which, you mentioned the whole issue of what could be said and not said in the discourse about Muslims. And that brings me to a question about how much does actually political correctness cover rather than heal the reality of sentiments, which is not only about Muslims, it's about other minorities. Mm. I mean, gypsies are still a massive problem. It's one of the things forgotten about the Second World War, that the second biggest category of victims were actually gypsies. And they're still a problem in Central and Eastern Europe. And it's not only Jews, but gypsies after the Jews, of course.
Yeah.
That's one thing. A question that was asked about the comparison between anti-Semitism and Islamophobia, I'd say rather than comparison, there's definitely a continuum between both.
Mm-hmm.
And it's one thing that is forgotten that, again, in Central and Eastern Europe, anti-Semitism is still very alive and well. There's a terrible joke that was made in Germany, maybe it was 20, 30 years ago, 20 years ago that I read that. That the joke is, what's the difference between the Turks and the Jews, the Turkish minority in Germany? And the answer is, the Jews have it behind them, the Turks don't yet.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very telling, you know, sociological tidbit, if you wish. And one thing that the whole Danish cartoon thing, the newspaper that published it, was notorious for its anti-Semitism in the 30s, right, whatever it was, because it was from Jutland, from Denmark, and that was a continuation of the same, but now it's much more difficult to attack the Jews in Denmark for obvious reasons, so we attack the others, but the mentality is the same. So that's a point. The other, to be the devil's advocate and to try to put it from a very different perspective, much of the discourse about this, as I understand, is about the West perceiving, I hate to use the term, Western scholars perceiving Muslim communities in the West, or Western intellectuals and academics perceiving Muslims in the West. But how much do Muslims themselves contribute to creating this reality? I mean, you have a spread, definitely, of Salafi jihadism in mosques across Europe. That's a fact. You have Muslims speaking a language that's strongly anti-European, anti-secular, basically anti-equality, anti-modern state, anti-nationalism, anti-democratic. And I wonder what the Muslim community is doing to address that. I don't know if there's much that's being done. One hears and sees horror stories about this in Europe. Actually, a point that was just mentioned, Muslims are always fond of saying the West essentializes us, but as we just heard, the West is always essentialized in this part of the world, and Muslims always tend to essentialize the West as well, as if there's one West, and it's both sides get into this. And I wonder if there's an awareness of this as well when we talk about Islamophobia, because it's a process. It's created by both sides, not just by one side.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Do you want to answer that immediately?
Or yeah, I think a better answer. Yeah. Okay. Try to answer that now, because that was already two or three questions. The first question relating to political correctness, that's a difficult term, right? Political correctness as a category. But you were mentioning gypsies, the case of gypsies, Roma. I think that is a good case to see the difference, the particularity also of Islamophobia. You can say things about gypsies and Romas in Europe, which would be impossible in most cases to say about Muslim individuals or institutions. So this is, you can sort of see this very well in France, where the most incredible violent remarks are regularly being made by mayors in villages, etc., against in favor of eviction of gypsies. Or last 2 weeks ago, someone, a politician, pointed suggested to put Roma in a camp to concentrate them in camps, right? So this kind of remarks. It's on a different level yet than Islamophobia, right? So that's, I think that is true and important to take note. It's also important because there is hardly anything resembling efficient lobby organization by Roma or organizations, and almost nothing on a transnational level. And Islamophobia is a different case because there are powerful, well-organized associations, sometimes European ones, defending Muslim interests or working against Islamophobia. So that's also a real difference, right? Now, you were saying Islamophobia is something which is being produced by both sides. I would definitely agree that is the case. But if you mention the case of jihadism, I think by now there is so much scholarship which shows that the hostility or the acts of discrimination, if you define Islamophobia narrowly, and also the broader politics which I try to analyze, cannot be reduced really or causally related to this jihadism. There's many mediating factors intervening, and it far surpasses, it far exceeds like what Muslims do. And there's, even in cases where you find that Muslim organizations have done a lot, like in Germany, to enter into security cooperations with governments, this is true for really all major European countries. Muslim organizations have entered into security cooperations. What is the benefit of this? By now we are able to evaluate, and many scholars have examined the benefits or the effects of these security corporations. Frankly, this is disappointing. The outcome, in spite of goodwill and efforts and surveillance and everything, is quite limited, right? So, last question, anti-Semitism, Islamophobia. You can say there are many similarities, many differences. Personally, I would say for France and Germany, the countries I know best, and Holland, it does not make so much sense to compare them, and there's not a continuum because we live in the post-Holocaust age. And for all these countries in public discourse, this makes an incredible difference. Not the historical event of the Holocaust, but the way it was remembered starting in the late 1960s. This has changed political life, and to make this comparison and to warn against Islamophobia with reference to Holocaust is almost, I find it morally objectionable, but historically also it is something which does not make sense, because the memory politics of Holocaust have really changed completely political life. And so this is, I think, weak comparison, I think.
Thanks for the opportunity. Thanks for. I have one question, actually. You're hinting at the idea that European government sort of adopting this essentializing idea on Islam from the migrants, right? Probably also some of them are Islamists also, and they are actually getting. Have a lot of number, right, in the Middle East, right? Those who essentialize Islam, right, and on the other way, the Western also take this as probably we can say their politics, right? But my question is, by presenting that the Western government shouldn't be like this, and based on their liberal idea, you said it's illiberal to essentialize, right? However, how far is liberalism itself try to to realize its ideals. We know that there are growing scholarly debates about that liberalism itself tried to, article by Mehta, Uday Mehta, is about how liberal or liberal people, they try to exclude non-liberals, right? They try to get some profit, right? Or why would they care about non-essentializing the Muslim? Mm. They are not profiting from that.
Yeah,
if they essentialize, they will profit. Okay, thanks a lot.
Okay. Let me answer right away. So why didn't I problematize liberalism and ask a question? Is this really a system where the liberal ideas are realized, where these are really the driving forces? Now, the what I try to do is basically, right, this idea of political rationality is based on the idea that liberalism is not only a political ideology which places the freedom, individual freedom rights at its center, but liberalism should be understood as a political ideology and as a set of technologies of power. And I try to approach the analysis of these technologies of power by using the concept political rationality. So the basic analytical move which Foucault makes is from taking a distance to the idea, to the perspective of liberalism as simply a political ideology, such as communism or any other political ideology, and to consider liberalism in its functioning based on specific technologies of power. And so this is, political technologies of power in which function.
But in the historically, there are practices, no, the history shows that the practice of liberalism itself often exclude non-liberals, right?
Yeah.
So I'm not always following the theory, right?
I'm absolutely in agreement with that. It's just that my analytical approach here would be different because it would, I'm not interested in taking the claims of liberalism and criticizing these claims, the ideological claims with regard to individual freedoms, but to think about liberalism as ideology and mechanisms of power, and to problematize liberalism from this respect, right? But I would not, so, and this would of course also lead me to say that to a specific form of criticism of liberalism, but it would be less direct than the authors who quoted.
Thank you very much for your talk. I have a couple of short questions. First of all, I wanted to ask about the idea of that is so much growing in Europe, especially in Germany, if I'm not wrong, about the Judeo-Christian roots of Europe. Right? This is a theory that has been promoted very much by the church and very much by the right wing in politics. And the idea is that the Europe has an identity that excludes Islam per definition, right? Now, I wanted to ask, what can you say about this thought, and what is the role of other faiths in the Islamophobia discourse? Because during your talk, you spoke about Muslims and the state. But also, I think there is another factor, Muslim states and the other religions, especially the historical religion of Europe. What is their role and how can they be interpreted? And the second is about what you called as a rationalizing Islam by understanding all what happens to the Muslim as a social phenomenon, as a self-identity construction, and by considering religion just as the field where the self-identity of Muslim are constructed, but not as important as it should be. So, and you mentioned the benefits and some of the limits of this rationalization of politics of Islam, etc. But my question is, how can a liberal state understand otherwise the phenomenon without compromising its own premises? Because the religion in itself, in a liberal conception, is a social a social construction or a social phenomenon, right? So everything that happens, it should be understood in these social terms. If the liberal state will understand in the religious terms, does this mean that he will compromise its own premises of laicity, of secularism, etc.? And the third one is about Islamophobia and the problem of applying this term to everybody. If, for example, we said that Islamophobia is the negative attitude toward Islam, now my question is, can somebody have a negative attitude towards Islam without being Islamophobic? This is the problem that Muslims have towards anti-Semitism, for example. It's a term that is being used for everything, so this means that sometimes you are obliged to think good of a religion, of its history. Now my question is, can somebody have an opinion that the history of Islam, the religion itself, is not good, can have a negative attitude to without being Islamophobic? What does make Islamophobic a negative attitude towards Islam, a negative discourse, let's say? What is the element that divide these two? Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Let me start with the last question. So the success of the concept of Islamophobia, which I presented in the first part, the concept of Islamophobia, which emphasizes that Islamophobia is stereotypical, it makes indiscriminate general statements about Islam in general, all through history, all Muslims. The absence of differentiating between Muslims, this is what is the major characteristic, the feature of Islamophobia. So you can have a negative opinion with regard to specific aspects of Islamic doctrine or practice, or with regard to specific Muslim groups. But once you move to indiscriminate general statements about Islam, then many people would qualify this as Islamophobia. Right? This is the, and of course, and so this is why the concept which I presented is successful, because it allows you to qualify, to disqualify certain forms of criticism of Islam without curtailing freedom of speech. Because what you curtail, what you disqualify, is emotional, irrational, like stereotypical talk. What about other religious groups? What is their role in relation to Islamophobia? You mentioned the fact that there is, in Germany particularly, this discourse which emphasizes the Judeo-Christian roots of Europe. The role is very diverse. We spoke about Jews, for example. It is important, I think, in many countries, in Germany, in Holland, in France, to emphasize that Jewish organizations are important in the debate about Islamophobia, because they, among others, have highlighted what is called the new anti-Semitism, which is particularly found, so it is claimed, among Muslim immigrants. Right. So this is something which, in Germany certainly, but also in France, has given great legitimacy to those who are in favor of more surveillance in mosques, etc., or educational programs, etc. So the idea that a new form of anti-Semitism, which is distinct with its, because of its focus on Palestine, it is different from historical anti-Semitism in Europe, this idea has gained ground considerably in Europe in the last 10 years. So this is like one important player, you could say. Certain so-called representative institutions of the Jewish community, and how representative they are is, of course, a very much contested question. And with regard to Christians, you find certain, like the Lutheran churches, which have emphasized the Judeo-Christian roots, evangelical groups, which have made important contributions also to this Islamophobic discourse. But how important are they? Even, I mean, to give you just one idea, like even the fact, it is often said the churches have emphasized the Judeo-Christian roots, they have fought for the inclusion of this paragraph, the preamble, the reference to God in the European Constitution. If you speak to representatives of the German churches in Brussels,
you will hear that this was not the priority. The priority for the churches was very clear. They employ hundreds of thousands of people and they want to discriminate and to continue discriminating on religious grounds. They want to be able, as a religious organization, corporation, to employ only Christians. This is like the absolute priority, and anything else was not on the list, and they got that through. And the law against for equal treatment in Germany is still applied in a very limited way in Germany. And this is the success of both the Christian and the Lutheran churches. This is, was much, much more important than any ideological debate about the Judeo-Christian roots. The last question, could the secular state consider religion otherwise than from this perspective of social rationality? Yes, it could. And of course, this is, the point is that there are different ways of rationalizing religion. And the fact that it has now become so common to consider the legality of certain Muslim practices by studying how these practices function in specific social milieus. This is something which started in the late 1990s in some countries, in other countries even only later. Now it has become normal, but before this knowledge was not even available to judges. And now it is available to every TV moderator and journalist writing about these issues. So to come back to the stage where this knowledge was not so widely available is difficult, but in principle, of course, it is a decision to take for policymakers, it is a decision to take for civil society actors, on which grounds the question of the space of religious freedom is being decided. And you can combine different ways of rationalizing religion. You can exclude certain rationalities. This is possible. There are choices to be made.
Professor, thank you very much for your lecture. I have a question about how do you actually define the center and the margin? Because as we see in the political discourse, the on one side the far right populist parties are using the Islamophobia as a central issue. One could argue though that even though they consist such a small number, they make other orientations. They put them in a situation that they have to answer yes or no. So they have to be involved in the discourse willingly or not. In the social level, on the levels of the society, on one side, the individual acts of what we can call Islamophobia against Muslims are not so common. Though it becomes common when we give the kind of a social, the public space, let's say the internet forest where people, individuals explain their positions and it builds upon each other. Demonstrations, media, which are very much occupied with the topic, which yet is one could argue it's marginal, but it becomes every now and then central for the political life and then for the life of the society. In the same time, what Dr. Samin mentioned, there are also Muslims, the radical side, who yet again are just a small part of the whole worldly Muslim population. Yet the small part of them creates a discourse which is becomes in the center of attention of the people. The number of Muslims, which is in some countries it's larger, in some countries it's smaller, yet it makes the question of Islam and Islamophobia in the center. So my question is how to define the center and how to define the margin? What is the relationship? Is it? Yeah. Is there any clear distinction between them?
No, thank you. That's a good question, an important question, and I should have elaborated upon that. Basically the answer is margins and center refers really So the basically the answer to your question is, how do I define, the question is, how do I define center and margins? It refers to the typology, the categories we usually use in Europe when we speak about mainstream political parties, and then we speak about right-wing or extreme right-wing or populist parties such as the National Front or in France or UK Independence Party. And these political movements are, for example, in the focus of much of the studies on Islamophobia. And so I'm now, this I would define as not mainstream, as marginal. Even if these parties in France are very important, they are marginal. They, many of their members continue to express views which are simply unacceptable. And they are constantly being criticized precisely for that. They are constantly trying to modify their image in order to accede to this mainstream respectability. So this is the differentiation I make. I make this differentiation because if you associate Islamophobia with these marginal parties, right-wing, extreme right-wing parties, you simply limit the scope of Islamophobia, because it is in mainstream political parties, it is clear, it is not contested that many of the views in this political spectrum are illiberal, they are not acceptable, they are based on prejudice, etc. So this is the point, my starting point. But you're right to say that these marginal parties are able in many cases to oblige the mainstream parties to answer them, to react to what they say. This is very much visible in France, notably, perhaps the country where they were most successful, where right-wing parties were most successful in changing the political agenda. Absolutely true, and I should have mentioned that, but you see, I introduced the concept of political rationality precisely in order to understand how this transition is functioning. Why is it that respectable political parties at one point can develop laws and policies which openly apply discriminatory policies to specific groups? This is what I'm interested in. And so I'm take note of the fact, and this is very important to see, that these right-wing parties were able to change the political agenda, but the question is why, what are the structural factors which enabled populist parties to change the political agenda? And so, and this is something I would try to explain with reference to these different political rationalities. Or you could also say with reference to the fact that European states are nation states, etc. So there are different ways to analyze it, but I'm interested in how this transition from marginal political parties to the mainstream is being enabled.
Okay, it's almost 10 to 9, so I will allow myself to ask one final question to Frank. This presentation has showed very clearly some of the limits of mainstream conceptualizations of Islamophobia, right? And in doing so, I think you've also unsettled and undermined the ways we think about how to address the problem, how to fight it, how to mobilize against Islamophobia. And your presentation did not really develop, but did mention at one point the local configurations of politics as the site through which perhaps mobilizations and attempts to counter Islamophobia might be more fruitfully conducted. So perhaps you could give some further examples of what you have in mind. What kinds of projects, contributions could activists, Muslims or otherwise, make in order to address an issue that has been prevalent and that cannot be reduced to simply the legal field and the legal rationality in these local contexts of politics?
One example would be, so when we speak about the social rationalization of Islam, we speak about how the practice of Islam is being understood in relation to specific social contexts, characterized by unemployment, by a bad housing situation. One way how this is being taken on, how this is being taken on in Muslim discourses and Muslim projects is, of course, to turn to develop projects of education, to reconfigure, to rethink the work, the profile of Muslim educators, Muslim imams. And this is something which started really in the late 1980s already in France, and this would be a specific local configuration of politics where the attempt to denigrate Islam through association with a specific social context is turned around, or at least the attempt is undertaken in order to show ways to make Islamic religiosity useful for reshaping a specific social context. This would be one way. The second one would be film production. There are important attempts recently now. Last year, the first Muslim Film Award was awarded at a big ceremony with 3,000 people attended. This is something which was based on the idea a tour through French mosque was undertaken, and people were educated. It was shown how to use video cameras in order to produce short movies of maximum five minutes. And these movies are put online. And this is something which enables Muslims to produce different kind of representation of Islam. And of course, this is not something which takes place, which immediately feeds into national debates. It's very much local, and it's limited to specific milieus in the first place. But this is what I have in mind when I talk about the local configuration of politics.
Okay, so let us thank Frank for his wonderful presentation. And we're all invited for some food and refreshments outside.